talk about are the singularities in cosmology, and I will in particular try to encourage you to understand that even in the simplest framework of Friedman cosmology, you can have something which is very curious. But first, let me make a couple of general statements which are related to the main topic of the conference, which are limits of physics and cosmology. So, singularities, you can read about them, about the definitions of singularities in the Stephen Hawking's Hawking and Lenin book, or in Walt's book, or whatever you like. So basically, one can roughly say that singularities are kind of infinities which appear in some physical or geometrical or mathematical quantities. The main issue is that simply if you have something infinite, you cannot measure this. Okay, it's impossible to measure. So that's why we can say that whatever the theory, it fails because of singularities, because you cannot make any observational predictions. So of course singularities appear in physics and appear in the simple framework of general physics, like in the Newton's theory. For example, if you have a spherical shell, it collapses and then there is a point singularity at r equals to zero. But the main issue which I'm going to talk about is are the singularities in general relativity. And the best known examples are just Big Bang singularity and Schwarzschild singularity. Schwarzschild singularity, I mean the central singularity, not an event horizon singularity. One can think of some intuitive definition of a singularity in cosmology or in general relativity. It has been, it has been mentioned already yesterday a bit about it. So singularities are kind of intuitively places or points where we have some pathologies, simply infinities or blow up of some quantities. Of course, also the physical fields can be singular, but there is a difference between, generally, if we deal with gravity, then gravity, all the fields reside in gravitational fields, so it's a worse problem if we deal with singularities in gravitation rather than in the physical fields. But physical field singularities and space-time singularities are usually quite independent, which we can learn, for example, from some investigations in the superstring theory or superstring cosmology. So, in fact, people were investigating a lot about how to define the notion of singularity, and I think most of relativists came to an agreement that the right definition is by the geodesic incompleteness. You can, for example, find it in Walt's book, which allows at least to practically detect them without somehow saying about their nature too much. In my talk, I will try to say something about these singularities because some of them will not be geodesically incomplete, so they will not, in fact, fulfill the basic requirement for being a singularity in the context of this definition. So the definition is just that space-time is singular if there exists at least one geodesic which is incomplete. So in fact, which cannot be extended in at least one direction and has only a finite range of a finite parameter. So this definition, in fact, gives, since we, to stick to the main topic of the conference, singularities, give really the limits. This definition gives us the limits of general relativity and especially cosmology. That's why we are looking for some quantum or whatever approach to actually get rid of these peculiar places or behavior. But as I said, geodesic incompleteness is something which does not necessarily gets you involved into all the subtleties which are related to what we actually face in particular examples of singularities which appear in cosmology. So I will try to get into these subtleties, applying some definitions which are somehow extra given to this basic notion of geodesic incompleteness. So for example, you can look at the definitions of the strength of singularities. These are the definitions which are which were proposed by Tipler. So in fact, Tipler's definition says that a singularity is strong if the integral like this diverges on the the approach to a singularity in proper time or in a fine parameter. So in fact, this definition tells us that an extended object is crushed to zero volume at the singularity by infinite tidal forces. Okay, and this is represented by three linearly independent geodesic deviation vectors which are parallelly transported along the causal geodesic. There is a definition by Krulak, which in fact is weaker than this one, but it tells us that a singularity is strong if a single integral like this diverges on the approach to a singularity. So physically, it means that the expansion of every future directed congruence of geodesics becomes negative somewhere on a particular causal geodesic. So in fact, this is for this definition works for the time-like and space-like geodesics. If you deal with null geodesic, then you replace with the Ricci tensor. And then to comply with the problem of geodesic incompleteness, of course, the definition, which is basic definition of singularity in relativity, you can use just the geodesic equation to study actually the history, the propagation of an individual particle on a geodesic, but also you have to take into account the geodesic deviation equation to actually study the properties of the singularities. I will also be using kind of a new approach related to the so-called Rachel-Dury space-time averaging procedure. What is also useful, it is useful to remind about the basic, the so-called energy conditions in relativity, which gives us some relations. These are written for, because I'm going to talk about the singularities which appear in the simple framework of Friedman cosmology, so I already written them down in terms of the energy density and the pressure, not in general by the Riemann tensor or Ricci tensor and the tangent vectors. So there is strong energy condition which tells us about attractivity of gravity, then null energy condition, weak energy condition, and the dominant energy condition. So one could say that the null energy condition is something which really is, if you break, if you violate it, it's really a big problem. But the rest of them also have the consequences. In fact, what we have known already from the early investigations in cosmology was just the Big Bang and Big Crunch singularities. So they come from as a consequence of the simple Einstein-Friedman equations. So in fact, the set contains two equations and three unknown functions, P, rho, and A. A is the scale factor, P, rho, pressure, and the energy density. But what is, has been done, what used to be done, that you simply added an equation of state to this set, and then eventually you could solve for the scale factor. That's a standard solution. W is the so-called the barotropic index, which is here, and the solution is for the scale factor is given like that. And in fact, what you get out of this is that you have a singularity, a Big Bang singularity for t equals to zero, where the energy density and pressure just diverge to infinity. And here you can see that these singularities, in fact, Big Bang or Big Crunch, they comply with the definition of being a singularity, singularities by using this basic definition of having geodesic incompleteness. So we have a Big Bang singularity where pressure, not only they are geodesically incompleteness, but also there is a curvature singularity. So the curvature has a blow up, which is basically is reflected by rho, the energy density, and pressure going to infinity. And for the closed spatial geometry models, we can also have a Big Crunch, which is a singularity which is in the end of the universe. And eventually, we can have some asymptotic behavior of the universe, which is just the theta phase, which is for empty, for open universe models. So in fact, first supernova observations, in fact, actually didn't touch this idea of having only this standard, I would say, Big Bang and Big Crunch singularity, despite that the cosmological term, of course, violated the strong energy condition, so attractivity of gravity was actually broken, but nothing new, in fact, appeared, bearing in mind this first data. But if one started investigating further the supernova data, in fact, here there is a picture from the paper by Tegmark from 2004, then one would see that in fact the cosmological constant gives the barotropic index, or has the barotropic index being equal to minus one. That's why I wrote down W greater than minus one here. So in fact, there was kind of a barrier which was not actually went through, barrier of having negative or repulsive gravity, but not too large repulsive gravity. From the picture here, you could see that it is allowed, or it was allowed due to this paper, that you could go further with the repulsion of gravity to have some kind of a, which is now called the dark energy, which has the pressure which is smaller, which is greater in sense of negative pressure than the cosmological constant. This type of energy was dubbed phantom energy, and it had some consequences, important consequences. Because in fact this type of energy violates a well-known cosmic no-have theorem, which says that even a small fraction of the cosmological constant which is present in the universe would finally dominate it. But this is not the case, in fact, if you admit phantom energy. Even if there is some tiny amount of a phantom energy in the universe, this is the phantom which would dominate the evolution. So in fact, phantom, as you could see, putting this on the left-hand side, violates the null energy condition, which is the weakest of energy conditions. or strongest in the sense of having some curiosities. In fact, with the phantom, it started to open the Pandora's box of some curiosities which were not the standard singularities as Big Bang or Big Crunch. And phantom, you can solve the equations if W is less than minus one, then you have that the energy density of the universe grows when together with the size of the universe. So the bigger the universe, it grows, the energy density also grows. This is due to negative work, in fact, done negative work done by the pressure onto the universe. Okay, so thermodynamically you can explain this that way. So this negative pressure does work onto the universe, and then then you can not only have the repulsion, but also you have the growth of the energy density. It's very curious. In fact, it has been investigated that, in fact, phantom leads us to the Big Rip singularity, which appears in a finite moment of time. Okay, so there is some time, T singularity in the universe, where there is a blow up of curvature, But not only the blow-up of curvature, but you also have this geodesic incompleteness in most of the cases, except for some null geodesics with this value of the parameter. But for timeline geodesics, it's just geodesically incomplete. It's a curious thing with the approach of the big rip singularity, since everything is in fact pulled apart from the large scales to the smallest and smallest scales. So the smaller the objects, later they are broken into pieces. And in fact, these investigations of phantom gave the people, we have John Barrow here, who actually already studied some ideas about the evolution within the Friedman cosmology of some possibilities to have some curious singularities. And in fact, due to the big rip investigations, there was a push of studies of other types of, say, in inverted commas, singularities. And one of them was a singularity which was proposed by John Barrow, where he simply didn't assume an equation of state which actually related pressure and the energy density, so they could evolve independently, so that one of them could be perhaps divergent, and another one would stay constant or finite. This was just by picking up some particular ansatz for the scale factor, like you can see in here, and then introducing into the Einstein-Friedman equations, and then you would get some energy density and pressure behavior. So in fact, what you have in the output, you have the so-called sudden future singularity, or type 2 due to the first classification proposed by Nojiri Odintsov and Tsujikawa, which in fact is a singularity of pressure only, okay? So only the pressure diverges, the energy density, okay, is constant, and the scale factor apparently is also a constant at a singularity. It's not zero, neither zero nor infinity. So here you can see the evolution. So in fact, the universe expands and then eventually stops. And I mean, this is the point for a singularity. So the scale factor is not blowing up, nor the energy density, but the pressure is divergent. So interesting observation is that for Schwarzschild horizon, the metric is singular, but the curvature invariants are regular, while for this singularity, the metric is regular, but the curvature invariants diverge. But as I said previously, phantom has observational support, whatever it is, and also these sudden singularities, whatever curious they are, they also appear in the theories which are supposed to, they claim that they provide us with the getting rid of the singularities, which is loop quantum cosmology. So these singularities, sudden future singularities, appear in loop quantum cosmology, despite that Big Bang and Big Rip do not appear there. And this is due to a quadratic term in the generalized Friedmann equation. So I would only emphasize that it appears in a theory which is physical. There are some other curiosities which are also due to John Barrow, generalized sudden future singularities. You can input a scale factor like previously given, but pick up different values of the parameter in the scale factor, and then you get something which is singular, but only at the pressure derivatives. First derivatives of pressure, or higher order derivatives. And what is interesting, that this singularity, apparently whatever it is, doesn't violate any energy condition. While sudden future singularity, I perhaps forgot to tell about it, violates the dominant energy condition. So because the pressure is greater than the energy density, the modulus of pressure is greater than the energy density. Then you can also have something which was found by Nogiri, Odintsov, and Tsujikawa, which is called finite scale factor, singularity. It's a kind of a big bang, but with the scale factor which is not zero. But due to the fact that it's, the scale factor is not zero, it has some interesting properties. Of being weaker than just Big Bang. So here you can see that the energy density and pressure, in fact, are divergent by the scale factor is zero. These people also found that they called it type 4. We call it big separation because of the fact that these are like generalized sudden future singularities, so the pressure derivatives actually blow up. But there is an extra thing for these singularities, that if you write down really a barotropic equation of state like this, then it make the barotropic index time dependent, then this index actually blows up to infinity. And there is also a curiosity which has no blow up of the pressure derivatives, and it's called W singularity or type 5, has only the singularity in a barotropic index which relates the pressure and the energy density. But it's very curious, very peculiar, in fact, behavior, because the pressure and energy density go to zero and W index go to infinity. So it's like zero equals to infinity times zero. Okay, but it's mathematically correct. Another fact is that this type of singularities appear in physical theories like scalar field. So let me make some kind of summary of what I enumerated already. So we have Big Bang, Big Creep, sudden future, generalized sudden future, finite scale factor. Then big separation and also some generalizations, W singularity and generalizations given by Yurov here. And I will not be talking more about it, but there are more subtleties related to a big reap found by Frampton and collaborators, which are called little reap and pseudo reap. So in fact, the time of a singularity is just shifted to infinity, while for regular type 1 or big creep singularity, time is finite, so it just happens at a finite Now the question is whether these curiosities are really the singularities or not, okay? So in fact, you can apply just geodesic equations, so you can make the proper studies of geodesic incompleteness. But if you just if you make the first glance, you can see from the geodesic equations that if you have the scale factor being constant but not zero, like for Big Bang, then nothing curious, nothing singular happens for the geodesics. They do not feel any singularity because a squared of ts is a constant, not zero, so there is nothing which blows up here. And it was actually studied by Fernandez Cambrina and Laszkos that in fact in most of these singularities, except for Big Rip and the Big Bang, of course, there is no geodesic incompleteness, and you can see why it's, for example, from this set of equations. But if you look at the geodesic deviation equation, so if you consider the bunch of geodesics, okay, then you can see that there is some blow up here because the Riemann tensor, in fact, blows up to infinity at, for example, I mean, this is in particular for a sudden future singularity, but for other singularities like FSF, final scale factor, it also does. So the point is now that since there is no geodesic incompleteness, then you can simply go through these singularities. Here, for a sudden future, you can see that actually geodesics, each individual geodesic, in fact, geodesics does not feel that there is a singularity, okay? So it's just, it can be continued through the singularity. But the physical meaning of that is that there is a peak, an infinite peak of of tidal forces, or tidal force, which in fact, where the geodesics actually evolve, so individual geodesics evolve, but the separation between them is growing and growing, then eventually this infinite value of the tidal force stops doing that and eventually can somehow make a turning point in which these geodesics start again being moving close to each other. So it's like a turning point for a harmonic oscillator. What is strange, as I said, individual geodesics do not feel singularities, but if then you take a bunch of points, okay, they can feel these singularities. But in fact, studied what is the behavior of a string. A string is a collection of points, in fact. Okay, you can use this classical string action given by Polyakov, for example, in Polyakov form. So we studied this, and there is an invariant string size, which in fact at a singularity remains constant, which means that most of these singularities, like sudden future, finite scale factor, big separation, W, and the generalized sudden future, the string can go through this singularity without being destroyed. This is not the case for Big Rip and Big Bang. Here, there is a classification of these singularities in fact, whether they are strong or weak in terms of the definition of tipler of Kulak. This was done by Fernandez-Hambrina, who actually used the Puisset series expansion to investigate that. And here you can see the whole list, okay, of these singularities. So we have a Big Bang, and in fact, it is strong according to both Tipler and Kulak. Big Rip is also strong. Little Rip, Pseudo Rip, I mentioned, they are one of them is strong, another one is weak. Then sudden future singularity is weak according to both of these definitions. And finite scale factor, this is the most interesting case, because it's considered to be strong according to Kulak's definition, but weak according to the Tipler's definition. And other ones are also weak. Now, briefly, whether these singularities have anything to do with the real world, okay? They are the sign of some physical interactions. So, in fact, I gave only the geometrical description of these singularities, but you can find them in many physical theories. So it has been also proven that, in fact, they can be fitted with the observational data. Here is the data from supernovae. Here is the combined bound from CMB supernovae and baryon acoustic oscillations. Okay, we could feed them to the observational data of all these three tests. This is for finite scale factor singularity. Okay, also they were fitted. Except that this finite scale factor can happen slightly further, I mean, in 2 billion years in future, while for the finite scale factor singularities, we even evaluated that they are very, very likely in the nearest future. But nothing special happens. Simply, geodesics can go back. Okay, so they can have a turning point. So that's why it's not very harmful for the universe. And I especially acknowledge the recent test, which is known as redshift drift test, which was proposed by Sandage, which is the test of the two light cones, past light cones, which in fact you can get the light from the two past light cones separated by 10 years period. Okay, thank you. So we also studied these singularities in the context of this redshift drift problem, and we found that in fact, they can mimic lambda CDM models, so they fit the data. Another thing which is related to the singularities, it's themselves. As I said, you have quite a few of them, and you somehow can differentiate them or can discuss how strong they are. So there was the definition by Tipler, Kulak, but it is also possible to make some other more exotic approaches. And here there is the application of the so-called Rachel Dury space-time averaging, which is, as you see, the space-time averaging of a scalar over the volume. And in fact, the application of this procedure, which was originally, in fact, invented by Rachel Dury to to actually show, to apparently show that if this average vanishes, then we have singularity free cosmology, which in fact was not the case. But one can apply this averaging to also to the these non-Big Bang models of the universe. And here, for example, is the the sudden future singularity model, which starts from the Big Bang, then has an evolution to a certain point, then carries on to the, then reaches the sudden future singularity, and then goes to reach actually the Big Crunch. And you can average the, that according to the definition given by earlier. And what it actually emerges that due to this Rachel Dury average has very different values for different singularities. For example, Big Bang singularity in fact has a vanishing Rachel Dury average, while Big Rip singularity has a blowing up Rachel Dury average. So somehow, in terms of this Rachel Dury average, in fact, Big Rip singularity is a kind of a stronger singularity. And then we have sudden future singularity. In fact, average is finite. While finite scale factor singularity, in fact, has this average sometimes finite, sometimes not, depending on the values of the parameters. So you can see that there are some subtleties for all these models. Okay, I have 5 minutes.
Okay.
So let me just briefly now jump into some topic which somehow was interesting in terms of trying to remove or change some of these singularities or replace them or exchange them between themselves. So here we actually try to do it in the context of very inconstant cosmologies. We actually were inspired by some papers which related, which were investigating the quantum effects in cosmology. It has been shown that these quantum effects can change the strength of singularities. So, for example, they could replace the sudden future singularities onto the finite scale factor singularities. So we tried to apply this idea to remove or change the nature of these various types of singularities in the context of very constant models. And in fact, what is going on here is that you can make the velocity of light varying, which enters the field equations, the Einstein-Friedman set of the field equations. Then gravitational constant also varies, and then you have the full set of equations, including the conservation law, which of course has the terms which are extra to the right-hand side. And, in fact, one can apply a slightly different type of of the different form or ansatz of the scale factor, that different from the one given by John Barrow. And here we applied some exponential function to have all in one. So this admits Big Bang, Big Rip, sudden future, finite scale factor, and also W singularities. And what we actually were trying to do. We were trying to actually to investigate how these singularities in cosmology could be influenced by the particular functional behavior of the varying constants being the functions of time. Here we can see that, for example, a singularity, of course, in the curvature singularity, in the sense of the energy density, can be somehow removed if we take such kind of the behavior for the gravitational constant. But while we actually get rid of the Big Bang singularity, then we get some kind of singularity for the gravitational constant, which here is just a kind of a scalar field, so physical field. Then we did also some investigations of in the context of sudden future singularities, so we could somehow remove the sudden future singularity under some specific choice of the parameters of the models, but at the physical consequence of having the velocity of light which stops at the singularity. But it's perhaps nothing special. It has been also found by Magejo that, for example, this behavior also is possible for the Schwarzschild singularity within the framework of varying C models. And also, the same is possible in loop quantum cosmology. So the same is also can be applied to varying G models. And here, for example, we found the values of the parameters which allow to for a change of sudden future singularity onto a stronger finite scale factor singularity in analogy to this quantum. Quantum effects models. Okay, I'm coming to the final. The subtleties are that somehow it is possible to remove some singularities, but it's especially these weak singularities, not geodesically complete singularities, but it happens at the expense of having some physical field singularity, which is not, I mean, people are familiar with that, okay? So somehow one would say that singularity in curvature is worse than in physical field. One could argue about it, okay? Because every field resides in a space-time, okay? While it's not the other way around. So this problem is actually faced in superstring theory, where you have to have somehow all this stringy field being consistent with the gravitational field. As a conclusion, I would say that one is able now to differentiate quite a number of cosmological singularities which are not necessarily the proper singularities in terms of the definition which was given by relativists, okay? Of course, as I said, some physics is behind this, and maybe these infinities which are related to these singularities are not harmful for the evolution of the universe. Of course, they can be influenced by varying constants, as I said previously, at the expense of having new singularities at the physical fields. Then final sentence, which relates to the topic, So as I said, some singularities, like Big Bang or Big Rip, are in fact the limits for cosmology. You have to look for some other theory to actually face them or deal with them. They really cannot be gone through. You can't go further. While these other singularities, which are non-Big Bang, non-Big Rip, admit some pathologies, which are infinities in some physical or mathematical, geometrical quantities, but they are not necessarily dangerous to the evolution of the universe, so they are not proper limits of cosmology. Thank you very much.